Ich möchte Sie ganz herzlich begrüßen hier im Namen des Deutschen Filmmuseums zu unserem Wochenende mit Lightcone-Filmen. Das ist die erste Zusammenarbeit mit dem Filmkollektiv Frankfurt und ich freue mich da sehr drauf und möchte insbesondere Luise, Gary und auch Felix, den ich heute gar nicht hier sehe, der kommt noch, ja, genau, ganz herzlich begrüßen und auch sehr danken für diese Zusammenarbeit. Als wir uns vor ungefähr einem halben Jahr zusammengesetzt haben, um zu gucken, irgendwie welches von euren geplanten Programmen hier bei uns am besten stattfinden könnte, da waren wir uns, glaube ich, relativ schnell einig, dass es das Lightcone-Programm sein soll. Und wir haben uns für dieses Programm entschieden, weil ich denke, dass es sowohl inhaltlich als auch sozusagen formal hier in unserem Haus gut aufgehoben ist. Wir sind eines der wenigen Kinos, die noch 16 mm vorführen können überhaupt und das auch in einer gewissen Regelmäßigkeit auch tun. Weil ja viele Werke der Filmgeschichte auch nur noch auf 16, also auch nur auf 16 mm vorliegen. In vielen anderen, auch in kommunalen Kinos, ist der 16 mm Projektor mittlerweile dem digitalen Projektor gewichen. Und es ist in den Kinos nur noch möglich, mit einem mobilen 16 mm überhaupt noch die Filme vorzuführen. Und eben einher mit sozusagen dem fehlenden 16 mm Projektor geht auch eigentlich, dass viele Vorführer auch gar nicht mehr richtig das Format irgendwie vorführen können. Genau dem wollen wir hier mit euch, mit eurem Programm was entgegensetzen. Und ja, ich freue mich auf dieses Wochenende und möchte das Wort an Luise übergeben.
David, ganz gleich. Oh, schon mal an.
Danke dir. Ja, Natascha, vielen herzlichen Dank. Ich möchte kurz im Namen des Filmkollektivs euch alle begrüßen und wir freuen uns, dass ja, ihr so zahlreich erschienen seid. Das Filmkollektiv, da sind Luis Burkhardt, Felix Fischel, wie gesagt, kommt gleich noch, weil er noch einen Gast abholt. Wir haben uns Mitte des letzten Jahres, 2013, zusammengeschlossen, ja, um eben Programme zusammen zu machen. Und unser erstes Programm war auch, wie das Lightcone-Programm heute, dem Experimentalfilm gewidmet. Nämlich hatten wir Wilhelm Hein im Festsaal auf dem Studierendenhaus da mit einer ja, unvergesslichen Vorführung von You Killed the Underground-Film. Und sozusagen dann in dem Jahr darauf haben wir mit den Mitteln der Leidenschaft und der Hingabe versucht, Programme nach Frankfurt zu holen, die ja, die uns, die sozusagen unsere Vorstellung von einem vielfältigen und wichtigen Kino sozusagen ja, verbildlichen oder versinnbildlichen. Und ja, und also wir haben dann eben unsere letzten Programme waren Chris Marker und Blaxploitation und hatten auch Telemach Wiesinger, der auch von Leitkunden verliehen wird, hier in Frankfurt zu Gast. Insofern ja, eben diese Vielfalt. Die uns sehr wichtig ist und so und das machen wir auch in verschiedenen Spielstätten. Und jetzt sind wir, wie Natascha gesagt hat, zum ersten Mal im Filmmuseum, was uns sehr, sehr freut. Wir freuen uns über diese schöne Kooperation. Nicht zuletzt, da einige von uns einen beträchtlichen Teil ihrer Zeit hier im Filmmuseum auch verbringen. Und ja, und natürlich schließlich stehen wir mit diesem Lightcone-Programm auch in der langjährigen Tradition der Reihe Avantgarden-Experiment, die Winfried Günther betreut hat, was uns nicht zuletzt eine große Ehre ist.
Gut, dann danke dir, Gary, für die einführenden Worte. Ich möchte mich auch an dieser Stelle wieder den Dank an Natascha zurückgeben, Natascha Gickers, und freue mich, dass wir hier heute und morgen hier sein können und tatsächlich von diesen 16 mm Projektionen auch viel bekommen können. Also ich freue mich sehr, dass wir hier diesmal eingeladen sind. Und da wurde auch jetzt sehr viel schon von 16 mm, vom Format, von der Projektion gesprochen. Und das ist tatsächlich auch ein großer Schwerpunkt dieser Archivpräsentation. Erstmal, und da muss ich auch sagen, da sind wir auch, da freuen wir uns, oder freue ich mich zumindest, weil die anderen weiß man nie so ganz, nee, also sagen wir mal, ich rede gerade für mich, weil das oft solche Filme, wie wir einige zeigen werden, sind immer mehr eigentlich auch in Museen gezeigt. Zum Beispiel der halt im zweiten Programm, Sons Lema, vorgeführt wird, wurde auch vor einigen Jahren in der Schirn gezeigt, was natürlich eine sehr gute Initiative, aber wo wir auch wieder in diese Tradition vielleicht auch zurückkehren oder vielleicht zumindest ist die Möglichkeit wieder geben, dass Experimentalfilm auch wieder im Kino gezeigt wird, in einer Zeit, wo es halt immer wieder oder immer mehr im Filmmuseum, also in Museen, Kunstmuseen präsent ist. Genau, und jetzt ein bisschen die Grundfrage sozusagen, wieso haben wir uns jetzt für eine Archivpräsentation entschieden und wieso eigentlich Lightcone? Archivpräsentation ist für mich vielleicht wichtig, weil es oft sonst von den Archiven selber gemacht ist. Das heißt, bei Jubiläen von verschiedenen Archiven hat man auf einmal, wird die Sammlung in eine viel größere Veranstaltung vorgestellt. Das hat man schon, Lightcone hat seinen 30-jährigen Jubiläum 2012, Arsenal 2013, dieses Jahr hat das österreichische Filmmuseum seine Sammlung großzügig und international präsentiert. Aber oft ist es der Fall, dass es eher im Sitzort gemacht wird, dass man halt eher die Filme an dem Ort zeigt, wo auch das Archiv seinen Sitz hat. Und da war für mich auch das Interesse, dass man eigentlich ein Archiv zu einem Ort holt. Und da war es auch wichtig, gerade dass auch eins von dem Ausland nimmt. Und als Deutsch-Französin habe ich mich auch für das erste aus einem französischen Archiv sozusagen mich entschieden. Und da gibt es auch, und warum Lightcone ist eigentlich eine lustige Geschichte im Sinn, dass ich vor 2 Jahren bei einer Veranstaltung, die Extra Trouble Jack Smith in Frankfurt, gearbeitet habe, wo ich da die Kopiedisposition Bestellung gemacht habe und wo ich eigentlich da kommen auch die Mitveranstalter in dieser Reihe, eigentlich viele dieser Experimentalarchiven in Kontakt mit denen gekommen bin. Und da hatten wir auch viele Kopien, die aus Lightcone kamen. Und da habe ich eigentlich dieses Archiv am meisten kennengelernt, sagen wir. Genau, wir haben jetzt, um dieses Archiv bestens vorzustellen, ohne an irgendeine Vollständigkeit anstreben zu wollen, weil die so unmöglich ist, mit mehr als 5000 Werke zu bekommen, haben wir uns entschieden, eigentlich ein Format, sagen wir mal, von Carte Blanche. So haben wir versucht, verschiedene Gäste dann hier einzuladen, bei uns zu haben, die dann auch in ihre Forschung, in ihre Arbeit verschiedene Schwerpunkte haben. Und haben wir uns dadurch ein ziemlich automatisches, heterogenes Programm zusammengestellt. Und unsere erste Forschung ist dann auch vom Sammlungsleiter, ganz logischerweise, und zwar Christoph Bichon, den wir heute Abend haben, wo ich eigentlich mich sehr, sehr freue und ihn auch sehr für die Mitarbeit bedanken will, da es für mich eigentlich eine sehr, sehr schöne Zeit bei ihm war, mit ihm war. Und genau, und Christoph Bichon ist Filmwissenschaftler, hat auch einige Jahre bei der Filmabteilung der Cinémathèque Française gearbeitet und ist jetzt leitet die Sammlung von Lightcone seit 1999. Und er hat eigentlich von uns alle in diesem Carte Blanche-System eine von den schwierigsten Aufgaben gehabt, und zwar soweit es möglich ist, eine Art sozusagen Programm zu machen, das viele einzelne Jahrzehnten überhaupt präsentieren können. Das heißt, er wird versuchen, eine große Bandbreite von verschiedenen Stilen, von verschiedenen Jahrzehnten uns vorzustellen. Und jetzt bedanke ich mich sehr bei Christoph Bichon und lade ihn zu Ihnen zu uns. Danke. Genau, die Einführung wird dabei in Englisch sein.
Hello everybody, thanks for coming. Unfortunately, I won't be able to use the Goethe languages. I won't use Voltaire languages, it would be complicated for me, so I will do it in the Shakespeare languages, which was not my natural born languages. So please excuse me if I have some difficulty to find my words sometime. I would like to say a great, great thanks to all the members of the film collective in Frankfurt, and especially for Louise, who spent a lot of time and energy to create this program and this event. We spent a lot of time to watch film, to discuss about film, to make selection, and it was really difficult. With Giselle, we were so surprised to discover the booklet when we just arrived this morning. That's a beautiful booklet, and I would recommend to all the people to buy it. It's not promotion. It's really a nice booklet. I feel really honored and in the same time not really comfortable to have my name in the first page. Lycon had I'm working in Lycon since 15 years, so half part of the life of this beautiful organization. People have worked before me and people will continue to work after me. And I would really precise that all the work of Lycon had always been a collective and common work of many people. And we are five people to work every day. It's so difficult to manage a so huge collection of film every day. So there's my colleague Emmanuel Lefranc, who's the administrator, my colleague Pierre Murillo, who manage all the computer and all the internet website, my colleague Baptiste Degas, who manage all the check and all the shipping of the print, and my colleague Jeanne Vellard, who manage all the invoicing and estimate part. And of course, we have a board of directors who's really involved and really active, with Gisèle Rapp-Mechler as the president, with Patrick Bukanowski, Jean-Michel Bourg, Claire Rognier, Christophe Guérin, Stefano Canapa, what else? Scott Hammond recently. And it's a common and collective energy. It was important to precise it. So Lycon now distributes more than 4,000 films from more than 650 filmmakers. We have a huge documentation center as well. That's an important part. We are a distributor, but in the same way, perhaps Louise was explaining this point, I don't know, as I did not understand correctly German. In the same way, we are in a strange position because we became, with the time, an archive. So we have a really huge collection of paper because a French archive had been founded by the filmmaker Rose Loder and Alain Alcitsud, and it was called at that time Archives du Film Expérimental d'Avignon, AFEA. And she gave all the books to Lycon. So if you are students, searchers, programmers, don't hesitate to come to the office. You can spend all the time you need to watch movie and to study books. We have a huge collection. We organize regularly a monthly screening called Scratch Projection. We have a huge website as well. We have received several grants from the French Ministry of Culture, and we have spent a lot of time to work on a huge digitization project. And now we have more than 900 films online. And we manage as well a French portal dedicated to experimental cinema and to video art. It is called 2425. It's a game about the speed for the video and for the film. It's completely free and you have a crazy amount of film available online for free. It was the first edition. We are working on the second. We will include a huge collection like the Pompidou Center for the film and video department. It was really difficult to make one program who could represent such among a film. So I make the choice, as Louise was working on a recent film, I make the choice to select only film before 15 years ago, and to select only 16mm print. Important to continue to see film as film. So, of course, you will see that some important names are missing, but it was simply impossible to have everybody I could speak about. Hans Richter, Stan van der Beek, Germaine Dulac, Henri Chomet, Marcel Duchamp, Peter Kubelka, Paul Charitz. They're not there, but it would be for the next edition, for the next time. And we have make the choice to show the film as a chronological order. And we try to have one film every 10 years. I will just say a few words about the film, try to not to be too long. The first film you will see is Grosstadt Zigeuner by László Molinás. László Molinás is a famous artist from Hungary. He was famous as a photographer, but he made a few films. He was a sculptor, a painter as well. He spent some time in Germany, was the director of the Bauhaus Institute in 1929, and was obliged to move. The Nazi closed the institute in 1933, and was obliged to move to United States in 1937. We distribute 7 films by Laszlo Molinage, and we have a lot of co-work with his daughter, who's an old woman now, who manage the Laszlo Molinage Foundation. And we have spent some time in order to obtain a new print, restore print. The film is a rare and beautiful document about the life of the gypsies in the suburbs of Berlin in 1932. The next film, the second film, would be Color Flight by Lane Lyle. Lane Lyle was first a filmmaker from New Zealand and secondly a sculptor. He's famous as one of the first filmmakers who used to paint directly on print with Norman McLaren. As Norman McLaren, Norman McLaren was Canadian. He moved to London in 1926 and worked for the GPO film unit, General Post Office film unit, was managed at that time by John Grierson. And he spent some time in London and after move to United States in 1944. The film of Lane Lyle have been able to integrate the collection of light cone through the work of Miles McKen, one of the co-founder of light cone, who was born in New Zealand as well. So he succeeded to create the relation with the Lane Lyle Foundation, still based in New Zealand, and to obtain 16 millimeter print. At that time, it was not so easy to have a print of Lane Lyle. The prints were more or less into the cinematheque area, and it was a lot of work for them to have the print. We still continue at the moment to have new print, but it's a lot of work, and especially to have 35 millimeter print, as all the first film of Lane Lyle were on 35, and we have reduction. For many years, Lycon was trying to obtain both formats, 35 and 16, but mostly 16, in order to be able to integrate all these parallel underground circuits in which it's more easy to screen 16 millimeter, as the equipment could be quite easy to manage. 35 needs special equipment and special place. The third film would be a film by Oskar Fischinger, a filmmaker from Germany, famous as one of the greatest animators since the beginning of the history of the cinema. Passionate by the synesthesia, the link between the image and the sound, and the idea to have a visual poem. As a German, he was obliged to leave from Germany in 1936, moved to the West Coast, directly to Hollywood. He worked in 1940 on the film by Fantasia by Walt Disney. Unfortunately, the relation does not work quite well. So you will see the first film he made after the work he tried to have with Walt Disney. The film of Oskar Fischinger have been able to introduce the collection of light cone through someone who had been really, really important in the history of light cone and in the history of the experimental film animation, William Moritz. He was really one of the biggest historian and film theorician. He was a filmmaker as well, who spent so many time and energy to fight for abstract animated movie. And William, at that time, made the link with Elfriede Fischinger, who was the widow of Oskar Fischinger. And Miles and Lian, the two co-founders of Lightcone, were close friends of Elfriede. When she died, a trust had been founded, Elfriede Fischinger Trust. And now the rights are managed by a foundation in the United States called Center for Visual Music. We try and we continue to have a long exchange with the CVM in order to have new print, new 35 and new restore print. And we distribute 27 films by Oskar Fischinger. After that, you will see a film by Robert Breer, important United States artist, who was a painter, a drawer, an animator. who was a sculptor as well, because he made some moving sculptures called floats, fascinated and passionate by the pre-cinema, who built a lot of incredible machines, reconstructing flip books, rotoscope. And he was a close friend of Ian and Miles at that time. It's the reason why we have been able to obtain the print. He died 5 years ago. We have got the chance to have it in Paris 8 years ago, and it was a beautiful moment. We have got to drink a whiskey before the screening. He would like to have a big whiskey. And unfortunately, the whiskey was too big. He slept during the complete screening of his film. And at the end, when I asked him, Robert, do you like the screening? He said, oh, I sleep, but I know my film quite well. That's okay. We distribute 27 films since 20 years, and now we are in touch with it's a French gallery who manage the rights, GB Agency. We recently have been able, with this gallery, to obtain 4 new films who are not distributed, and we are in touch with the Anthology Film Archive in United States in order to have new internegative. After that, of course, we can't. It was impossible or difficult to organize a screening about Lightcone without one movie by Stan Breckage, one of the most important United States filmmaker, with a crazy production, more than 200 movies. When he was still living, we have some really good relation, and he was sending a lot of new print without any trouble. At that time, we distribute 87 prints, and we are in touch now with his widow, Marilyn Brackage, who manage all the rights. And just last year, we have got 10 new prints of films who were not distributed in the past. So we continue with this work with famous titles like Dante Quartet. The film you will see is one of the major films of Stan Brackage, Must Light. To create this film, he takes some natural elements that he put directly into the 16mm clear leader. Difficult to have a program without the other father of underground cinema, Mr. Jonas Mekas. Born in Lithuania, who was famous as a filmmaker, of course, but as a crazy activist who had engaged all his life into the fight for the avant-garde cinema. As a as a creator, as a theoretician, as a programmer, as an archivist, he moved to New York in 1949, create the film culture in 1944, Filmmakerscope in 1962, and Anthology Film Archive in 1970. Famous for his diary, really prolific, he made more than 60 movies, some really long, like Lost, Lost, Lost or Walden, who are 3 hours long, and we distribute 18 of his movies. This movie, Cassis, had been found in Cassis, in the north of France, when Jérôme Hill, the filmmaker, was living there, and he was inviting a lot of friends. The Jérôme Hill Foundation still does exist in Cassis. You will see the next one would be La Vache qui rumine by Georges Auret, an important French filmmaker, really active in the 60s. And we begin to work on 16 and after on video. He had been an important curator for art, a photographer, a teacher. He managed a cinema for many years. He had been programmers as well and photographer. And this film is really famous and really funny. The title will explain you what's happened. If you're interested by his other pieces, his old work, we have digitized all the film by Georges, especially the film from the late 60s, beginning of the 70s. Not easy to see, so don't hesitate to have a look on the website. After that, I have made the choice to select someone who was important for the Britain part, Malcolm Legrais. Really important as a filmmaker, painter, performer, teacher, writer, famous for theoretician, famous for his book Abstract Film and Beyond. He was the founder of the London Filmmaker Cup in 1966. taking the models, he tried to reproduce the way of working created by Jonas Mekas 4 years ago with the New York Filmmaker Cup. It was important for the London Filmmaker Cup because at that time they were the first one to create an alternative lab. And a lot of artists used to create some crazy installation, expanded cinema pieces through this alternative lab. We can talk about Guy Sherwin, William Raban, Peter Guidall, Jill Everlay, and many others. The film Berlin Horse could be screened as a double screen or as a simple screen. It's up to you. It was more easy to choose the single screen, and the soundtrack had been made by Brian Eno. After that, we will show, it was obvious, a film by Miles McCann, the co-founder of Lightcone with Yann Bovet. Yann is an artist born in New Zealand, and he was really interested since the beginning. He used film to create installation and environment. We use Super 8 16. And he's fascinated by animals and by garden, by plants. It's a common passion we have together. Now he's working for an organization called MIR, based in Nantes, and really, really active. We met some beautiful events. They have an alternative lab. They organize regular programs, a residency. So if you travel in France through Nantes, don't hesitate to visit them. They are really nice people and really active people. We go back to France with one of the most important figure and most important characters of French artists. Not so famous, strangely, outside of France because of the language, I think. Maurice Lemaître. Maurice Lemaître is still alive. He's 88 years old now. He worked in many, many fields as a painter, as a writer, as a poet. The founder of a Lettrist, of course, a Lettrist movement with Isidore Isou, as a sculptor, as a noveler, as a choreographer, as a theater pieces writer. He wrote more than 100 books. We try to have a complete collection our documentation center. It's not completely complete, but we try to work on. He made this famous film in 1951 called Le film est déjà commencé. Is the film already started? And is one of the first ones to use the fan footage at that time. He's really prolific. We distribute 51 of his films. And we try to work on to be able to obtain grants in order to work on the restoration of his work, because his work is not in good condition. For Le film est déjà commencé, for example, he was using the original was a nitrate material, and the original does not exist anymore. One was with color, and so at Lightcone we have the only print with color. We had been at that time in the 60s a reduction from the 35, so we have really to work on. It's a next project. We go back to Japan with Yota. It was important to have Yo into this program. Yo is someone really, really important in Japan as a teacher, as a filmmaker. He was really important to bring some European experimental film to Japan, and on the opposite with his students, to bring a Japanese experimental movie to France, to Lightcone, and every 2 years for seven or eight times, we have organized a tour every 2 years. A tour will take place in many organizations and many venues in France, and sometime in Belgium as well, in order to show two complete programs of 1 hour of experimental movie from Japan. And Yo was able to bring the filmmaker with him. And after that, the film stays in Lightcone. So it's the reason why we have a so important part of Japanese movie. Some names like Yun Miyazaki, Naoyuki Tsuji, Riko Sonoda, Ishiro Sueoka. And to finish, a film... I make this choice in order to not forget Vivian, a film by Yann Bovet, the co-founders, and Vivian. Vivian, I will begin by Yann, who's the founder of Lightcone, someone really important, an activist who had took a lot of time in order to make program, to write some article, to teach. He do some performances and some installation as well. He now live in Brazil, in Recife, where he continue his work as a creator. Jan make a lot of programs in many festivals. And he's a crazy programmer. And now he works on a place called Bico Bico. He's really prolific. We distribute 54 of his films. Vivian was someone really close from Lightcon. She had been a part and a member of a board of directors for many years. She's a filmmaker and a programmer. She's really involved into the feminist movement. She's the founder of the Jerusalem Film Festival. She's a crazy traveler, so she traveled a lot. She shoots a lot of beautiful images. We distribute, and she had a lot of work on the sound and the relation on the sound of the image. And she introduced a lot of part of humor. Lightcon distribute 20 films of Vivian. And I make the choice to have this one with a work between Jan and Vivian, because he had been made by both of them when they were traveling together in Moscow for a festival, and after that they have decided to include some archival image. This film could be shown as a double screen on 16, but as it was more or less complicated to have the sync between the two images and between the sound, they have decided to print a 35mm print with a 216mm image inside. So you will see it in 35. Thanks a lot. I hope I have not been too long. And you're welcome if you have any question. I will be with Giselle in the area. Don't hesitate if you want to discuss.
So, ganz kurz eine kleine Einführung. Entschuldigung erstmal für die Verspätung. Wir kommen jetzt zu unser zweites Programm zur Lightcon, zur Archivpräsentation von Lightcon. Und diesmal werden wir uns auf zwei bestimmte Filme konzentrieren, die auch 2 Jahre voneinander entfernt sind. Und zwar Touching von Paul Sheritz und sonst Lemma von Hollis Frampton. Und dafür habe ich Vincent Deville heute zu Gast, der auch über Schnitt im Avantgarde-Film promoviert hat und dazu ein Buch auch in 2014 veröffentlicht. Also wir haben hier einen Spezialist. Und ich freue mich auch deswegen sehr. Und wir hätten auch eine Möglichkeit von einer kleinen Diskussion, wie die Zeit es erlaubt, nach den 2 Filmen. Und genau, Vincent Deville ist auch Filmwissenschaftler und Dozent an der Universität in Montpellier und hat auch mehrere Jahre bei der Cinémathèque Française gearbeitet. Und jetzt würde ich gleich zum Vortrag gehen, der ungefähr 20, 25 Minuten lang ist, und dann gehen wir zum Film weiter. Vielen Dank, Vincent Deville.
Vielen Dank. Thank you. And so maybe I will make a short presentations of the 2 films. And if there isn't time enough, and if you are still there at the end of the films, we will have a discussion, a little discussion. Well, I say if you are still there, I hope you will be still there, of course, because they are quite difficult movies. I don't like the term, but they are not easy movies. That's why I'm going to say a few things before the screening begins, and to develop a few ideas about the films themselves, and maybe to give you also ideas watching them. I intended to name this screening Adieu au langage, Goodbye to Language. Adieu au langage, the title of the film, of last film by Jean-Luc Godard. And the 2 films we are going to see in a moment is their main topic, their main theme is really, one of their main themes is really about language. And it is quite a big matter for many filmmakers and experimental filmmakers, especially in the 1960s and 1970s, and both films are from this period, the film by Paul Sharitz and the film by Alice Frampton. First of all, yes, I wanted to thank Film Collective and Louise and the team for inviting me. I also really wanted to make a tribute and wanted to thank Christophe and Lightcone for the amazing work they make. And this is a really good idea and good project to organize these 2 days of screenings, because yes, they are doing an amazing job and which allows us to screen all the films we are seeing these 2 days, and without their work we could not see these films in this quality like we do. Yes, I said the question of language was very prominent in the 1960s and 70s, related to the question of structuralism, and they are called structural films because they analyze very precise parts of the film as films, film as a language, and the problems that comes from this question: is film language or not language, and what is film? All these films try to question film as film, but also many of them try to destroy language and to eradicate language, and they do it with film as film of a new kind of language, but maybe a language without any words anymore. And that's really a concern of Paul Sharitz, as you're going to see. I wanted to also quote a few other philosophers or art critics, art historians, or filmmakers themselves when they speak about this question of language. For example, a French art historian, Jean-Marie Pontevia, who wrote, "What if the main goal of art was to unarm the speech?" Or, for example, a longer quotation of Stan Brakhage. You've seen a film of his in the precedent screening, and with a very famous quotation by Brakhage. I won't read all all the quotation, but maybe stress on the last sentence: imagine a world before the beginning was the world. The word, a world before the word. And that's why Brakhage tried to imagine why making his films. And for example, he imagined the eye of a child in the grass, watching many colors as what we call green. How many colors are there in a field of grass of a crawling baby unaware of green? Words are in a way reduce our capacity of imagination with naming things with one name, green for grass, as there are many greens in a grass, and especially for a baby who doesn't know words, who doesn't know speaking. Also, Jonas Mekas, you've seen also a film by his precedently. It's not really about words, it's about thinking, it's about planning. Too much planning. When there is a plan, the planner wants to put it into practice. And behind every plan, don't doubt it, there is always a gun or a tank. So let's get rid of all planning. To make a plan, you have to think first. You have to concoct a plan in your head. Let's get rid of all that thinking. We think too much. So we are going to see films that get rid of thinking, in a way, that get rid of language, and that get rid of words. And we are going to see how they try to do this. First, with Paul Sharitz, maybe was born in 1943 and who died in 1998. He made most of these films between 1962 and the very beginning of the 1980s. He was a filmmaker, but also a theorist, a painter, and a teacher, and which is also the case of Ollis Frampton, and they both worked as colleagues, as teacher, at the University of New York in Buffalo in the United States. Also, this quotation from Arto is quoted by Charitz himself in a text called Notes on Films, and which was a text to apply for a grant for money to make films. And the first things he puts on it is all writing is pig shit by Antonin Artaud. And then in his note, it is difficult for me to verbalize about my intention, not only because the films are largely non-verbal experiences, but because they are structured so as to demand more viewers, their attention and appreciation, and so on. But non-verbal experiences, and that's what you are going to see in a minute. For example, I put this image again, on the right you have a film by Paul Charitz called Word Movie. And it's only made of words, but each word appears only on one image in the film. So this is a very quick film and you can't really read the words, and all words are merging together as they appear very quickly on the screen. So it's Word Movie, but you can't even recognize the words when the film is projected. Touching, here are a few images of the films you are going to see, is what we call a flicker film, and you will understand why when the film is projected, because the film is very flickering, and that's very weird and very nice. We are in a room perfect for, we are in a Paul Charitz room, I think, in a Paul Charitz film theater, you see? So this screen theater is perfect. These are also images from the film you're going to see from Touching. So the film alternates with motifs and also scissors trying to cut a tongue, so also distracting language. On the sound, you will hear destroy, 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 destroy all along the movie. In a way, at the end, you can't even recognize the word destroy, as it is repeated over and over. And also the film is made of just color images, so trying also to eradicate, to erase language and words and all images. And I think the link between the two films we are going to see is that they are going to unprogram you, unprogram your thinking, trying to unprogram your vision. And maybe it's not brainwash, but maybe to unprogram your brain with all what you have learned before. Maybe we can discuss this after after the screening. Yes, and what this kind of film is trying to search is maybe a thing named by Malcolm LeGrais, you've seen Berlin Oz before, to reach material realism against narrative illusion. All the films are trying to fly away from narrative, so narrative illusion would be the thing to avoid, and to get what? To get material realism, a new kind of realism based on the materiality of film. This is also a way to explain the structural films. Also, these are films, maybe in an historical way that comes back to Dada, the films of the avant-garde, the 1910 and 1920s for the films, who wanted also to erase language and to erase all rational logic, which can be very authoritarian, which means power, authority, and whatever, and what these films are trying to avoid and to flee. Yes, you have the quotation by Hilary Gryce and also Peter Guidall. These are, for example, a kind of a script, or maybe better, a score by a films, other films by Paul Charette. As I said, who was also a painter and who designed his films in this way. So this is also a way to design a film, avoiding language, avoiding words, and reaching new areas for filmic experiences. Hollis Frampton, 1936-1984, was also not only a filmmaker, but a photographer, and also a teacher, and also a theorist of films, of film. His films take place in the core of minimal art, minimal films, and the Zorn Slema is a kind of minimal art, but Frampton did more minimal than this. For example, just filming a lemon and calling the film Lemon, but which is more than this, of course. I won't explain tonight. Zorn Slema, the title, is from is named for a mathematical axiom. Don't ask me to explain you this mathematical axiom. I can't, and I won't do this. But also, the film is questioning and destructing a language. You'll see how. And so these are different images, different shots of the films you are going to see in a minute. And Frampton said about his film, it's a kind of long dissolve, a very attenuated dissolve from primarily verbal to primarily non-verbal concerns, the last part of the film. And I have to explain what this film is made of, because it's very important. And it's easier to understand the film if you know what it is made of. Yes. The film is made of three parts. The first part will begin in the dark, in the black. You only will hear sound, a sound that is text written, by someone. And this text, it's good to know it, is from the Bay State Primer. And what is a Bay State Primer? It's a child's alphabetical primer to learn reading. So the beginning of learning reading. So there will be sound, but no image. This part is about 5, 6, 7 minutes about. Then the main part of the film, the total film is 60 minutes. The first film by Charette is 12 minutes, I think, and this one is longer, it's 60 minutes. The main part of the film is made, so I have to read this to be really clear. The main body of the film cycles through 1 second shots of signs, each beginning with a successive letter of the Roman alphabet. These are the shots you have seen before here. The Roman alphabet, which contains 24 letters, J and U is the same, I and J and I is the same, U and V are the same. And each time the alphabet begins again from the beginning, these are cycles of the alphabet, each letter is gradually removed by a shot of something completely different, which has nothing to do with the letter that was at this place before. But each time the cycle begins again, you will find again the shot that has replaced the letter. And the shots go on and on each cycle. So you will understand it very easily when you will see the film. And so this part ends when all the letters have been replaced and removed. So that's why I say this is a kind of erasing our own learning and mechanism of language while doing this. And then last part of the film, these are the kind of shots replacing the letters. And then the film, of course, will end in white, in total white. We just will see a couple, a man and a woman, and a dog, which is also, I think, maybe an allusion of the last film of Jean-Luc Godard to this part, the man, the woman, and the dog that we find in Adieu au Langage. And they are walking away in the snow field, and then at the end, the image becomes all white, and we have also this time sound and image. And on the image, this is a text about light, a medieval philosophical text called On Light or the Ingression of Forms, a text from 13th century, and talking about form, material, composition, and totality as four concepts derived from the light and from the materiality of light. So again, this is maybe the same subject as Charit's film. Both film deals with language, with light, but in very different ways. And that's what I wanted to do, to put the both film together and to maybe to ask you, to ask the film, what they have to say each other. So these are also film experience for the viewer, a specific kind of experience. Charit's said, I think of my present work as being occasion for meditational visionary experience. I think both films are, and so I would be very interested to discuss your own meditational visionary experiences after the screening. Thank you.
No? Where is that? I've seen these films twice now, it's not so many times, but even though better than just seeing them for the first time. And in your thesis, you quoted Jonas Mekas saying that even after seeing him three times, he still found it very difficult to talk about this film and to write about this film. So my question, of course, would be, since you've written a lot and talked about it, how many times did you have to watch it until you had the feeling you were comfortable enough to talk about these films?
Not so many times. I actually, yes, I must acknowledge, but this is one of my favorite films. but I've seen maybe it six times and not so much. But each, what I think very interesting is that each projection is its screening is different from the preceding screening. That's to say, but I will ask you questions very soon, because as I said, I'm very interested of what you thought or what you experienced during the projection. But yes, this kind of film allows to see a different film each time you see the film, because it's so complex. It's so it seems very simple in the form, but it's very complex in what you can do with it actually, and that's what I think interesting. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So,
I was a slave of this film. I have to follow him. And
yes, but I think the film wants to free you from language, but you are still captured by language. That's what you say. Actually, yes, we can see pictures or we can see words. Either, and I think that other persons in the audience have different experience as yours. But you saw words. You saw words, and you was compelled to read words. So this is one experience, and I think the most interesting thing of this film is to confront the experiences of the audience to maybe understand things about language and our relationship to language, to image, to cinema, to the world, to everything, something much bigger than language and cinema, actually, but about the world. Someone else?
Yeah, I had a question kind of related to this one. I'm interested in maybe not how these films seek to destroy language, but maybe resist and reflect on the destruction or the process of destruction, because I would agree that in the first film, in The Sherets, even the word destroy is itself not destroyed because of the irregular placement of it. So you always hear destroy amongst the, you know, other kind of almost destruction parts of destroy. And in The Frampton, I think that because you're set up from the beginning to read this pattern of the alphabet, you never really get outside of language, even when we are left with pure illusion. So do you agree that maybe there's a tension there or a resistance?
Yes, absolutely. The film tries to destroy it by erasing, clearly erasing the words and the letters on the screen. But of course, there is a lot of resistance because our brains are programmed to and have learned. The film begins on this thing, learning language. And once you have learned, it's very difficult to forget. I think this is a question. And to get out of this language, of course, is something very difficult. And it's very normal that there is a resistance, there is a tension, and it's actually the subject of the film. It's not only, but one of the subjects, I think. Yeah.
In the last film, the last word was time. And I find it interesting that that when the letters or the words or the pictures are replaced, they're always replaced by a process. There's always something that happens. There's only one picture with the tree in the snow that is pretty minimal. All the other things, there's always something happening.
Which is a process too.
Which hints at time, of course, as well, because wintertime. But what I'm saying is that...
Because the tree is growing. Not at the same speed that the other actions, okay. But it's also a process, actually.
Right, okay, good. But the point I wanted to get at is that the discussion you have at the moment is that how you're destroying language. However, you never get away from time. Okay, you never get away from time. Signs themselves might have a kind of internal quality to them that they always are there, or that's at least alluded to. But it is interesting that the letters or the words or the pictures are replaced by a process, even the tree that grows very, very slowly. Okay, and...
Yes, but you're completely right, yes.
You don't get away from time itself, all right?
Yes, which is another question of the film. Time, rhythms, and cycles. I think one of the other last words is cycle. Time, there are other occurrences in this area of language, but which is, and the very last words we hear on this sound, we begin with letters, with A, B, C, but we end with numbers. We end with 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and there is a sentence saying something about dances, dance, rhythm, and also, yes, the question of time is always here. It's about our relationship to the world and what how we are conditioned, how we are experiencing things we have learned, and the world which we belong to. And so for Frampton, yes, all the replacements I made by actions occurring, which sometimes beginning, sometimes ending, but also the big question is there an end, is there a beginning? And which is also, we come from the black to the white, and also at the end, it's very hard to say, is it the end of the world? This man, woman, and dog disappearing in the snow. Is it the end, or is it a beginning of something else? Is it a newborn is going to come, or is it the end of something? I also have the very strong feeling when we see the whole cycle for the last time, that we quit a world, that we see the world for the last time, we see the fire for the last time, the water, the all these things, we know we see them for the last time because all the letters have been replaced, all the words have been replaced, and at the end we know that the process is at an end. And I think also I find it very moving because I have this feeling of an ending world, and then we have again something else. We have this man and woman, but with not knowing if it's an end of or a beginning. So yes, we are also crossed by the question of time, this question of language, but also very related to the question of time, yeah. Which is a main concern for Frampton.
Just two short remarks. I think it's narrowing down what the film does to claim that it's destroying language. On the contrary, it seems to try to install a new language, which is the more important point of the film. And my second remark is in regards to your lecture at the beginning. I found the quotations from Brakhage and Mekas quite misleading in regard to these films, because both films are meticulously planned in advance, down to the last detail.
Yes, for the first remark, destroying language. Yes, of course, destroying language. When I say this, I go very quick, and it's destroying a kind of language based on words and based on alphabet and based on letters. And of course, there is something else proposed. As there is a replacement, as letters and words are removed and replaced by something else, so it's kind of an attempt to replace a kind of language by another kind of language, a more visual one, maybe, and without any words anymore. But as we said, the words remain, and the words are not ready to leave us and remain. I'm not sure I've quite understood the second remark about the quotations of Mekas and Brakhage. Ah, okay. Yeah. Yes, you're right. Yes, that's an important point of this film and of the most of this film, maybe the Sharitz too. Yes, they are very, in a way, very planned film. But also to propose a new place for the author of the film, a place where, of course, there is still subjectivity in the work of Frampton. He chooses the words he's filming, etc. He chooses the actions he is going to film, but also he decides some things prior to making the films. A system is also a word appearing at the end of the film. And so then once he has decided for this system, every shot longs 1 second with words and words replaced by actions. Once the system is decided, then the work of the filmmaker is totally different. It's not really. It's like getting out of the film for the filmmaker. Okay. In a way, finding a new place for a filmmaker, less subjective, and maybe more objective. But it's also there are nuances to. It's not really completely this thing. But,
First, I thought this film has only an abstract structure. It's about a play to with words and pictures. But when I think about Holy Frampton, I'm talking about. But now I think at the beginning there is this black picture and this moralizing quotations from school books with sin and very oppressing words about behavior and how to behave. And at the end there, with a white picture, there is this scientific text or about the four points, how a world is built in a perfect way. Though there is a meaning in this film more than I thought first, because I was concentrating on the structure of the film. Mm. But it has a message, and it's a ethical or a philosophical or a simple message. Yes, from very moralizing use of words to a more scientific use of words and four elements with this.
I won't say the film has a message. I couldn't say that, and I couldn't say what the message is exactly.
Question mark.
But yes, at the beginning, this is a very, as I say, a Bay State primer. So it's a method to learn to read, and it's really related to religion, as it was a method used by the first pilgrims from Europe in the United States. So it was this method of these times, and so it's really related to religion. Frampton said that he almost learned language with this kind of method. He almost learned to read with this kind of method still in his period, in his age, as he was growing in a landscape, in a very Puritan family. He doesn't say that was a nightmare, not at all, but that was also this kind of method used very long after they have been created. So it's again the idea of getting out of this kind of methods. But also I didn't say one thing, and we didn't say this until now. Also, all this also is really a game. There is a really playful playful approach doing this film, and puts us viewers also in a place of players playing with this language, with these cycles of A, B, C, and trying to get and to know which is the next letter to disappear, and what is going to replace, and at what moment, and the action. You talked about the progressing action. Is the wall going to be totally white or not until the end is until the film is going to end? It's also a very playful relation I think we have to this film. It can be kind of stressing or frustrating, but also very. I think it's a game. Whereas Charette's film is much more a weapon or something aggressive, and the films are not at all made in the same ways, in the same with the same matters, and with the same. They have many links, I think. But they are totally different in what we can do with these films and what these films do to us also.
Do we have last questions?
I wanted to ask, could you say something about the title of the Hollis Frampton film? Thorn Slammer, what does it mean?
Yes, as I said first, it's a mathematical axiom. And I can't explain it. So, and also also Frampton says it's not at all demonstration of its axiom. Well, roughly, it has to do with small unities and big unities, and how small can be contained in a bigger, and a bigger can contain the smaller, etc. So it has also to do with this question of man, language, time. Very basical questions, actually, very basical philosophical questions or even metaphysical questions. But Frampton was also very fond of mathematics. He used very often structures or mathematical structures to structure his films. For example, the Fibonacci suite, which he used in one of the films, which is to say every length of a shot is calculated with a progression according to the Fibonacci suite. I don't know if it's a suite, yes. Suite is a that's a name in yes, and other examples, can't remember now, but yes, another title of a film with in reference to mathematics. So he was really, despite he tries here in this film to I think to try to get out in a way from a kind of language, Frampton was very passionate by the mind. And also it's a question what our mind does with one film like this. I think the these are two minds melting together, our mind and the mind of the film, or the film as a mind. And yes, Frampton was very passionate by all kinds of sciences, sciences of language, sciences of mathematics, sciences of biology, of everything. He was actually a very good reader and passionate by knowledge in general. He was a kind of scholar, very passionate by philosophy and everything. So yes, Zoran Slema, maybe that's why. If it doesn't explain anything. But
okay, we'll then end it here. The next screening starts in a few minutes. So I hope you enjoyed it, and see you perhaps the next screening. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
So, hallo. Wir kommen jetzt zu unserem dritten Programm von Leitkohlen, und zwar zur Reihe, die ich 16 mm nicht in den 60er Jahren, sondern in den 2000er Jahren. Und zwar kam diese Idee zustande aus einer eigentlich sehr logische oder offensichtliche Weise, im Sinn, dass in diesem Programm, also in alle Programmen, die wir zeigen, gibt es eigentlich hauptsächlich 16 mm Filme. Und weil es auch auf eine gewisse Weise sehr lange auch das bevorzugte Format bei Experimentalfilmen war. Deswegen ist es auch oft, dass man automatisch bei solchen Programmen bis eigentlich beim Anfang der Experimentalfilm zumindest sehr oft auf 16 mm stoßt. Und da für mich ein Archiv nicht ein Ort ist, wo man nur Klassiker oder sehr frühere Filme lagert, sondern auch neue, war es mir auch sehr wichtig, dass man genau diese Werke auch zeigt, dass man auch merkt, dass ein Archiv sich nicht nur für Ältere, nicht nur diese Recherchearbeit an Rechtsinhaber oder Kopien, die dann nicht mehr verfügbar sind, wie Christoph es erwähnt hat, aber was er auch gesagt hat, ist tatsächlich auch viele Regisseuren, die bei denen repräsentiert sind, die auch im Leben, die auch vor junge Regisseuren sind, also beziehungsweise auch seit nicht so lange halt Filme drehen. Und damit wollte ich eigentlich sozusagen dieser Teil der Sammlung von Leitkohlen auch vorstellen. 16 Meter war für mich auch interessant, weil es ein Format, das immer weniger präsent ist, besonders im Experimentalfilm, da viele Regisseure sich auch autoproduzieren, also beziehungsweise sozusagen alles oder einen Großteil von der Produktion selber bezahlen müssen und 16 mm eigentlich immer auch teurer wird. Und es ist auch eine Zeit, wo halt immer mehr Labor schließen. Und deswegen war dann es für mich interessant, wie viel gibt es denn noch auf 16 mm, das seit den 2000er Jahren überhaupt gedreht ist? Was macht man damit und wer bleibt da? Weil viele Regisseure haben auf 16 mm gedreht und sind dann auf Videoarbeiten umgestiegen. Das hat man sehr oft gemerkt. Da ist auch eine Ausnahme, die morgen kommen wird, und zwar Un Rêve ist halt auch von Patrick Bogdanowski. Das ist ein Regisseur, der sehr, sehr lange auf 16 mm gedreht hat, aber sein letzter Werk ist dann auf DCP bzw. digital. Den zeigen wir dann auch digital, aber das ist eigentlich unsere Ausnahme. Und in diesem Programm habe ich versucht, also nicht mich auf einen oder eine Regisseurin dann zu konzentrieren, sondern nahe Heterogenität oder verschiedene Genres mit verschiedenen Regisseuren, die sind mit alle möglichen Thematiken oder Techniken eigentlich auseinandersetzen. Das heißt, eigentlich zu jedem Regisseur könnte man eigentlich eine Filmreihe machen. Die Zeit haben wir leider nicht. Deswegen, wenn einige Filme Ihnen sehr gut gefallen, ganz einfach bei Lightcon reinschauen und programmieren. Wir kommen, ich komme, macht es. Genau, und was mir auch wichtig war, ist, dass man nicht nur bekannte Namen, die jetzt noch auf 16 mm drehen, sondern auch die Senioren repräsentiert. Und zwar habe ich auch die ersten zwei Filme, sind halt von jeweils Natalie Dorsky und Frédéric Devaux, die in der Szene, der Experimentalfilmszene, zumindest sehr bekannt sind. Wir haben aber auch, habe ich auch im Programm zwei, also zwei Regisseurinnen vertreten, die aber seit einer kürzeren Zeit zumindest Filmarbeit repräsentiert sind, und zwar Deborah Stratman und Maria-Helena Clark. Genau, und beim ersten Film, also von Nathaniel Dorsky, aber was ich vielleicht noch erstmal einmal erwähnen will, ist bei dieser 16-mm-Problematik, was man bei diesen Regisseuren oft merkt und sieht, ist, wie eigentlich sie mit der Problematik von den Schwierigkeiten des Entwickelns des Films eigentlich umgehen. Und zwar ist es bei einigen so, dass sie entweder selber ein Labor gegründet haben, wo sie sozusagen ihre eigenen Filme dann entwickeln können und diese und alle Techniken anderen beibringen, sodass es halt noch eine Möglichkeit gibt, in einem gewissen Raum diese Filme noch weiterhin zu drehen und sie zu entwickeln auf Filmkopien. Und andere zum Beispiel sind aktive Mitglieder von Laboren, die sich vor kurzem, also die relativ neu sind, aber immer mehr Erfolg haben und immer mehr Bekannte sind. Und zwar in der Nähe von Paris, L'Abominable, das auch ziemlich bekannt wird mittlerweile und die auch alles per Hand machen. Und das ist definitiv eine Richtung, die man bei diesen Regisseuren sieht, aus ganz praktischen Gründen auch. Was man bei anderen, das sind eigentlich auch die beiden gleichen, die genau dieses Labor entweder aktiv mitgestalten, aber auch, wie ich gesagt habe, dass sie sich auch selber autoproduzieren, beziehungsweise nicht damit ihr Leben verdienen können, beziehungsweise mit der Tätigkeit als Filmemacher, nicht unbedingt mit dem Filmbereich an sich, sind sie dann oft, ist für viele von denen eigentlich das Experimentalfilm eine Gattung, die sie so weit wie möglich immer weiter verbreiten wollen, repräsentieren wollen. Und viele von denen haben auch Festival gegründet, die sie dann manchmal abgebrochen hat durch verschiedene Gründe oder immer weiter betreiben. Genau, jetzt glaube ich, komme ich so ein bisschen langsam zu meinen Filmen. Und zwar der erste, wie gesagt, ist von Natalie Dorsky. Wir haben jetzt eine Produktion von 2013, der hat zwei letzte Filme gemacht und 2014. Die laufen leider Montag auf der Biennale und deswegen können wir sie nicht zeigen. Hätte ich gern gemacht, aber sonst fahren Sie ganz schnell nach Wien und schauen Sie die nächsten Werk. Die sind gut, kann ich bestätigen. Aber leider hier nicht. Deswegen habe ich dann ein Werk von 2013 ausgewählt. Das ist eigentlich, der zeigt oft gerne zwei Werke nacheinander. Das können wir aus Zeitgründen hier nicht machen. Aber wir zeigen dann einen Song von ihm. Und es ist ein Regisseur, der eigentlich sehr auf 16 mm besteht. Und zwar so sehr auf eine gewisse Weise, dass er auch, dass seine Filme überhaupt nicht vorhanden sind auf einem anderen Format. Also selbst für Programmierer nicht, für Kuratoren nicht. Da wird halt eigentlich immer die Kopie gezeigt. Und das sind auch Filme, die, glaube ich, vielleicht gibt es ein paar Ausnahmen, aber eigentlich hauptsächlich auch stumm gedreht sind, mit auch einer Stummfilmgeschwindigkeit, also 18 Bilder pro Sekunde. Und das gibt den Film so, würde man sagen, so einen meditativen Effekt. Und man sagt dann oft von Natalie Dorskys Filmen, dass sie halt auch sehr schön sind, wenn es überhaupt Sinn macht. Und wenn ich seinen Namen jetzt finde, genau, Steve Anker von der Cinemathek in San Francisco hat gesagt, Sie sind eigentlich der Erste, der auf diese Idee kam, visuelle Filme zu machen. Also wenn Sie mir vielleicht erklären können, was er mit visuellen Filmen mag, wäre ich Ihnen dankbar. Aber auf jeden Fall war er davon sehr erstaunt. Und der P. Adam Smith, den man eigentlich im Experimentalfilmbereich immer wieder eigentlich trifft, hat sich... Wie bitte? Sydney, genau. Danke dir. Der hat über Natalia Skłodowskis Film eigentlich sich fast erstaunt. Der hat, wenn ich es zitieren kann, "Why you film so unrelentingly beautiful? Make me more uncomfortable." Also sozusagen, was wir vorher gesehen haben bei mit Paul Sherritz und Holly Frampton, ist definitiv nicht, was wir bei Natalia Skłodowski sehen werden, sondern tauchen dann in eine ganz andere Welt. Das ist dann unser erster Film. Wir führen dann weiter mit Frédéric Devaux, die auch Mitglied im Verein von Lightcone ist. Und wir zeigen einen der ersten Filme der K-Serie, den sie gedreht hat und die sich auch viel mit Materialität des Films beschäftigt, die sich viel mit Farbe und auch oft 8mm Filme selber in 16mm Film auch integriert. Und auch sehr viel mit sozusagen Kratzen und sozusagen wirklich mit der Materialität des Films eigentlich beschäftigt, um ihre Geschichten zu erzählen, die sich da auch sehr viel mit ihrer Vergangenheit und mit sozusagen einer Trennung von einer bestimmten Herkunft, die sie hat. Im dritten Film, Flyscreen, haben wir jetzt einen Australier, der auch, das ist der Regisseur, den ich vorher so indirekt erwähnt habe, der sein in den 2000er Jahren auch sein Labor gegründet hat, wo er eigentlich handgemacht sozusagen Super 8 Filme auch entwickelt und dieses Handwerk sozusagen immer weiterbringt. Und bei ihnen wird oft eigentlich experimentiert er auch oft mit der Natur und viele sagen eigentlich, das wären tänzerische Landscape, jetzt habe ich den Wort nicht mehr. Genau, und der arbeitet auch sehr viel auch mit verschiedenen, mit Kameratechnik. Also die Filme sind auch in der Kamera geschnitten. Dann haben wir zwei Filme, aber nicht ganz nacheinander, von Peter Miller. Einen, der A Film That Cleans Your Eyes heißt, und der macht eigentlich genau, was der Titel meint. Das heißt, der ist auch so platziert, ungefähr in der Mitte, sodass die Pause auch seine volle Wirkung haben kann und die Augen am besten säubern kann. Und dann wird es von Nanu Nook and Cranny von Franzien van Everdingen aus den Niederlanden eigentlich gefolgt, die eigentlich kommen wollte, aber leider nicht konnte durch irgendwelche Gründe. Und die grüßt sie, also ich muss Grüße ausrichten. Und die arbeitet mit einem optischen Printer, das sie ermöglicht, sozusagen Bilder von verschiedene Filmen eigentlich zusammenzutun. Das werden Sie dann ganz schnell verstehen, was ich damit meine. Und dann kommen wir wieder mit einem zweiten Film von Peter Miller, Vrolog, der sich eigentlich mit vielen verschiedenen Mechanismen des Kinos, also Licht, Projektion, Flicker oder auch Publikum, und das sieht man auch in Vrolog, dass sehr große Arbeit mit Licht eigentlich passiert. So, bei den zwei letzten, das sind ungefähr unsere jüngeren Regisseure im Sinn, das sind Leute, die seit eine kürzere Zeit als andere zumindest Filme gedreht haben. Und zwar ist unser vorletzter Film After Writing von Marie-Helena Clark. Die eine Collage aus verschiedenen Materien, also die sie sozusagen selber gedreht hat, kombiniert sie mit Filmen, die sie dann sozusagen gefunden hat, um den Zuschauern einen tranceartigen Zustand zu geben. So, und beim letzten Film, und damit endlich gleich, und dann können wir die Filme sehen, von Deborah Strutman, das ist auch unser längster Film des Programms, der dauert ungefähr eine halbe Stunde und beschäftigt sich, also das ist von der Deborah Strutman, die in Chicago sozusagen sich als Dichter und Essayistin präsentieren würde und aber auch Dokumentarfilme dreht. Und die beschäftigt sich hier in Ode nach Tibehe mit Kontrolle und Surveillance in Amerika. Gut, jetzt wünsche ich Ihnen eine schöne Projektion und bis bald.